हेलो व्यूवर्स, वेलकम टू सीईसी लेक्चर्स। माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर प्रीति जगवानी, आई एम असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ कंप्यूटर साइंस फ्रॉम आर्यभट्ट कॉलेज, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली। आर टुडेज टॉपिक इज अमोर्टाइज्ड एनालिसिस। इन दिस सीरीज ऑफ एल्गोरिथम्स, वन ऑफ वेरी कॉमन टर्म विच वी हेयर वेरी ऑफन is analysis of the procedure, analysis of the algorithm, and so on and so forth. So when we talk about the term analysis, generally we mean to say asymptotic analysis, but here today we are going to study about one more, or you know, a different kind of analysis, which is amortized analysis. Now in amortized analysis, let us see what actually is this amortized analysis, when we are going to use amortized analysis, and when specifically we will be using asymptotic analysis. So if you can recall, we can say asymptotic analysis is the analysis when we talk about a kind of input set which is going growing large enough, and with respect to that growing input we need to analyze the algorithm, that how much time this algorithm is going to take. If my input size, which is generally defined by n, is going to be greater and greater. So this is what the concept when we use our normal asymptotic analysis. So asymptotic analysis with basically is used basically with respect to or we can say in terms of input sizes. But let us understand a scenario where we need to perform analysis of a sequence of operations rather than going with a single operation, and within that sequence of operations we have kind of a good mix of operations, in the sense some operations are actually slow while most of the other operations are fast, but the occasional operations are slow also. So here in this type of situation, when we talk to or when we need to analyze this sequence of operation in which a couple of operations, or we can say occasional operation or very few operations, could be very slow while generally these other operations are faster, we use amortized analysis. So in amortized analysis we basically analyze a sequence of operations, and after that analysis we guarantee a worst case average time for that sequence of operations, and that this worst case average time is going to be lower than the worst case time of a particular expensive operation. Now let us try to understand this whole scenario with the help of some data structures and the associated operations. So the data structures, which are data structures whose operations are analyzed using amortized analysis, we can say we have hash tables, which are generally implemented in the form of dynamic tables, or we can have disjoint sets, or we can have splay trees, or maybe red black trees also. So all these are the data structures whose operations are analyzed using amortized analysis. Now let us understand how amortized analysis is going to help in analyzing the operations associated with these data structures. Consider a simple scenario of a, let's say, hash table. So all of you can recall that what actually a hash table is. Hash table basically we can say is a kind of table in which the values are stored according to the value of key, and searching is actually easier because by performing some operation on that particular key we will be able to determine the location of that particular item into our hash table. So what happens when we talk about simple hash table insertions? So how much table size we can say is good enough in order to avoid collisions. So basically here comes a trade off between space and time, in the sense if we are going to make hash table size big, the search time will become faster because you know it is going to avoid the collisions, but space required is going to become very very high and vice versa. So if we say that we need a you know kind of a smaller table, so in a smaller table collision of you know chances of collision are more, and then obviously it is going to affect your search time. So basically the in this hash table insertion there is a trade off between space and time. So how are we going to you know say what space or how much space we are going to you know we can say assign to a simple hash table. So the solution to this trade-off problem is actually a dynamic table or dynamic array we can say, where instead of you know fixing one particular size for the table, we can always you know expand the table as and when require, or we can always limit the table or shrink the table size when the table is not in use a lot. So we need to increase the size of the table whenever it becomes full, and we need to decrease the size of the table whenever it is you know we can say underutilized kind of thing. So yes, that kind of data structure is basically we can say is that implementation is dynamic table, and using this process of dynamic table we are going to implement hash tables. So how are we going to work with this dynamic table in terms of expansion? So as I have told that expansion is going to trigger when a table is going to become full. So basically what are we going to do? We will allocate memory for a larger table of size, typically twice the old table. So let's say my table is full and now again I want to insert a particular element. So I'll be you know growing the table to double of its original size or the earlier size, and then I'm going to copy the contents of old table to the new table also, and then after copying the contents of old table into the new table, we will obviously you know because of memory utilization or memory optimization, we need to free the old table, and if the table is having a space available, we will simply insert the new item. If space is not available, then we will expand the table and that expansion will be of the double size double than it's the previous size we can say, or the earlier size. So here let us try to understand this whole concept with the help of a figure. Initially the table is empty, and there was you know as the table is empty, size is obviously zero. Now we have inserted one item, let's say one we have inserted here. So initially there was no table, and with the you know we can say insertion of item number one, we have created one table of size one. Then there comes another item which is let's say two. Now we don't have a space here, so we doubled the size. Earlier the size was 1, now the size is 2. Then we insert next item which is 3. Again we don't have any space in the table because there were 2 slots and these 2 are actually filled. So we will be inserting item number 3 when we will expand it. So initially there was 0, we have you know started with 0 and then they made the size as 1. Then again while insertion of second item or the item number 2, item 2 we can say, we have expanded it to double. Then while inserting item 3, we again need to expand it to 4 because we don't have a space here. So this stage or till this point you can see it in the figure that now we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So earlier the size was 1, then we doubled it 2, then we doubled it 4, and the total inserted items is 3. Now we have inserted one more item, 4. So again, now my table is full. And in the next step, when we want to insert the next item, which is item number 5, I don't have a space. So again, I'm going to double the size of the table. So earlier the size of the table was, you know, 4 blocks, we can say, or for 4 elements. Now it has doubled and become the element, become the size. The size has become for 8 elements. Now we have inserted 5, we have inserted then 6, we have inserted 7, and let's say we have inserted 8 also. After insertion of 8, when we again try to insert the new element, which is 9, again it is going to be an overflow. Next overflow is going to happen when we insert 9. And from this point, the table size would become 16, because earlier the table size is 8, and now on the insertion of item number 9 or on the insertion of 9, the table size would become 16. So essentially this is happening here. Whenever we have a space, we are just inserting an item, and whenever we don't have any space, we are just doubling the size of the table. After doubling the size of the table, we are taking all the elements from the older table and we are copying it onto the new table also. So now, if you can see, how are we going to calculate the time complexity of n insertion? We have inserted n elements, and now we want to, you know, we can say calculate the time complexity. So by a very simple analysis, we can say worst case cost of an insertion is going to be order n, because what are we doing? We are actually, you know, not directly jumping to the location, but we are, you know, taking the elements and then copying it. And the worst case of an insertion is order n, and therefore for n inserts, it is going to be n into order n, which is of order n square. Okay, so here we are settled with a kind of bound, which is of order n square. We can say yes, it is an upper bound, but it is not a tight bound, or it is not a tighter bound, as all the insertions are not going to take the theta n time. All the insertion is not going to take the similar time, as if you can, you know, as you have seen in the previous figure, that whenever there is an, you know, a space available, we are just inserting the item. Whenever there is a space not available, then we are, you know, doubling the size. And then after doubling the size, we are, you know, copying the old elements, and then we are inserting the newer element also. So every time we cannot say that the insertion is going to take theta n time. So in this situation, the bound, which is order n square, is actually an upper bound, but it is not a tighter bound. So how are we going to have a tighter bound? So here comes the concept of amortized analysis, and how we are going to use this concept of amortized analysis in the scenario of this dynamic table, I'll be explaining it in a moment. Another example could be, let's say we have a hash table, and most of the time the searching complexity is order 1. Yes, because that is what, you know, we can say is the idea behind hash table, in that is to reduce the search time complexity, and it is order 1 because we are just, you know, taking the particular key which we want to search, apply a function on it, and after applying hash function on it, we are going to get, you know, the exact location of that particular key within the hash table. So searching is very, very easy, but sometimes it is going to execute order n operations. And when this sometimes is going to happen, let's say we have a collision. So in case of collision, this order 1 efficiency will not, you know, we can say is not sufficient, but it is going to give you some more, you know, complicated or more costly operation, I can say. So in both of these two examples, one is, you know, dynamic table, which we have seen, another the scenario of hash table, in which we can say search or insertion an element is, you know, constant time operation most of the cases, but when a collision is going to occur, it needs order n times operation for that collision resolution of collision resolution activity also. So in both of these example, we have seen in the dynamic table, we have seen insertion is fine unless there is an space, but this insertion could be very, very costly if the space is not available, because that time we need to expand the table, we need to copy the old table into the newer one, and so on and so forth. So sometimes this insertion could be very, very costly, otherwise it is just an order one operation. In this example of hash table, we can say, you know, searching is fine, or insertion, again, let's say searching is fine, it's a constant time operation, but till that point, unless it is, you know, not tingling up into a collision, the moment it, you know, gathered into collision resolution, it is no more an order one operation, it needs order n operation for that collision resolution activity. So in both the cases, what actually is happening here is, we have, you know, kind of we can say sequence of operations. Some of them are, you know, we can say most of them are pretty okay as far as complexity is concerned, but occasional operations are actually very, very costly. So in this type of scenario, we can have amortized analysis, because amortized analysis is about the average of the performance of all the operations on a large data set scales, while asymptotic analysis is about how the performance of a given operation scales to a large data set. So in asymptotic analysis, we generally talk about a single operation, we can say, while in amortized analysis, we generally talk about the average performance of all the operations over a large data over a large data set, or over a large input set, we can say. Then coming to classical asymptotic analysis. So in classical asymptotic analysis, it generally gives the worst case analysis of each operation without taking the effect of one operation on the another, while in amortized analysis, all the operations are going to, you know, interplay for each other. Interplay for each other in the sense that effect of one operation is going to be on the next operation, whether it is, you know, we can say a less costly operation, or maybe a more costly operation, whatever it is, its effect is going to, you know, going to be seen on the other operations also. So the operations are not, we can say, you know, not it's not the scenario that these are the operations are not affected by one another, while they are essentially affected by one another. While in classical asymptotic analysis, we generally don't consider this scenario. We consider the worst case analysis of each of the operation without taking the effect of one operation on the another. So we have seen two basically important points of the line of difference between amortized analysis and asymptotic analysis, where asymptotic analysis is about the performance of a given operation on a large data set, and amortized analysis is about the average of the performance of a sequence of operations. That is the first difference. Then we have, you know, in asymptotic analysis, operations are, we can say, operations are considered as independent of each other, while in amortized analysis, they are not considered independent of each other. And then coming to the next difference, we can say amortized analysis is going to focus on a sequence of operation, as I told you, and interplay between operations is, you know, seen in case of amortized analysis, and thus it yields in an analysis which is precise, and we can also say it depicts a micro level analysis because the operations are not considered as independent of each other. Independent of each other in the sense, now let us consider that example which we have taken, dynamic table. So when we start analyzing the operations of dynamic table, first of all we will analyze the sequence of insertion. Now within that sequence of insertions, we can say most of the after a particular time when your table is grown up enough, we can say most of the operations are just order one operations. We just need to go and just insert the element onto a particular position. While if we talk about some few operations which are insertion, within those few operations, what is actually happening? The table is getting doubled, the old elements are getting copied, and so on and so forth. So those operations could be costly. So we will be taking those costly operations and those normal order one operations as a kind of bunch of operations which are affecting each other. We will not take those kind of expensive operations and cheaper operations separately. This doesn't happen in amortized analysis. So basically your amortized analysis focus on a sequence of operations, not on a single operations. And yes, it is going to yield an analysis, or it is going to produce, it is going to give an analysis which is quite precise, we can say, and it is going to always depict a micro level analysis, while your asymptotic analysis is generally considered as a macro level analysis. Then amortized analysis is applied to algorithm, to all those algorithms where an occasional operation is very slow but most of the other operations are faster. As we have seen the table of example of dynamic table, also let's say in hash table we are talking about some searching operations. So in searching operations, what is happening? Generally we are going to get our key for that which we are searching into we can say in one order one complexity, because that is the importance or that is the idea behind hash tables. But if there is any collision, so in that collision sense we will, or in the situation of that collision, we will not be able to take that thing, that order one thing into mind, because in the scenario of collision, order one operation or order one efficiency of search operation is not possible. That collision resolution activity has to be taken care of, and that activity will obviously we can say give your complexity hype of more than order one. That is what we can say. Now in amortized analysis, generally now you are familiar that we are going to analyze a sequence of operations, that is fine. But one important point in amortized analysis is within this analysis for a sequence of operations, we guarantee a worst case average time for that particular sequence, not for a single operation, but for a sequence of operations, we guarantee a worst case average time, and more importantly, that worst case average time is lower than the worst case time for a particular expensive operation. So you can say in a way, we are kind of averaging out the expensive operations over other kind of less expensive operations. So we are generally taking whole sequence of operations, and the complexity is being averaged out for all. So basically amortized analysis is going to give you an upper bound. It is the average performance of each operation in the worst case. Now here a very important term is average performance. Now why this average performance is an important term, I am coming to that. Now apart from that, amortized analysis is concerned with the overall cost of a sequence of operations, but The very important point here is it does not say anything about the cost of a specific operation into that sequence. Whatever it is talking about is about the sequence of operations, not for a specific individual operation within that sequence. So, amortized analysis is concerned with overall cost of a sequence of operations, and this overall cost is kind of, we can say, averaged out for the whole sequence. So, amortized analysis, we can say or can be understood to take advantage of the fact that some expensive operations may pay for future operations by somehow limiting the number or cost of expensive operations that can happen in the near future. So, some of the expensive operations may pay for the future operations. This is kind of, you know, we can say, we can take one more example here in which we can say a person is drawing a salary monthly, and you know, the kind of its operations or its expenses are kind of in within limits, but you know, one particular month in, you know, kind of a sequence of years, it over a sequence of various months, we can say that person is going to buy some furniture or maybe going to buy some car. So, that is going to be an expensive operation, but that expensive operation is not very often. So, here we will not perform asymptotic analysis, but we will perform amortized analysis. Now, amortized analysis may consist of a collection of cheap, less expensive, expensive operations too. However, amortized analysis, because of this averaging argument, is going to show or is going to produce the average cost of an operation, and that average cost of an operation is going to be cheaper than the cost of expensive operations also. Now, this is different from average case analysis, wherein averaging argument is given for the inputs of a specific operation. So, average case analysis is about the averaging argument over all inputs for a specific operation, which is different from this, you know, averaging out the cost. So, here inputs are modeled using a suitable probability distribution, and in amortized analysis no probability is involved, while in case of asymptotic analysis probability is involved, because we generally consider that all size input sets are equally probable. So, amortized analysis does not involve probability, while asymptotic analysis involves probability. And there is also another different notion of average case running time, where algorithms use randomization to make them faster, and expected running time is faster than the worst case running time. So, in this lecture, in order to summarize what we have all seen, we have seen what actually the asymptotic analysis we have, you know, generally covered. Amortized analysis, along with the basics of amortized analysis, we have seen in what kind of scenarios amortized analysis is going to be used, and what is the line of difference between amortized analysis and asymptotic analysis. These topics we have covered in this lecture. Hope you have, you know, good learning. Thank you for a patient hearing.